There we go. That should be right now. Okay. Send out a tweet, Aruni. How are you guys doing today? Anyone out there yet? Hey, what to do, Hobbit? How you doing, Alice? Cool, welcome. Doing well, thank you. Busy, trying to get ready for a bazillion things all at once. Yeah, I've got myself getting ready for San Diego Comic-Con. Yeah, no, it's I actually kind of like it. It's kind of cool. It's a little different, but we'll see. It is what it is, right? Anything for cosplay. Oh my gosh, Falcon's Crest, there it is. Yeah, it's definitely different, but I do like it. Yeah, it probably will get even a little bit more silver over the course of the week. So stay tuned. But especially in this light, it's actually showing up pretty silver. Templar bird. Okay, tweet is out the door. That's good. So, now I gotta start pulling up stuff for the episode today. Oh my gosh, there's so much stuff going on. So many things that I've got to be ready for because my players are crazy and I love them for it. I'm just going to have so many things up and ready to go. I need that just in case. And I probably should have. I don't think I need that. I don't think I need that. I definitely need this, though. I need my map. I need my map. I need my map close by. Hey, yeah. Well, that's another good guess. Actually, that's a really good guess of what it'd be for. That actually might be something I have to put on my list. Do a little original Blade Runner. That could be cool. That could be cool. Didn't think of that one. That's a cool one. How you doing, Lightfingery? Good to see you. Don't mind me as I attempt to like get paper stuff in the same place as other stuff. And oh my God, I'm nervous about today, man. There's just a lot of stuff going on. I claim I've got it all prepared. Okay, now I can have a sip of coffee. I can actually move my video where it should be. I need my camera focused down a little bit more. There go. Oh, got my Game Master t-shirt on. Because I figured it matched the hair. But yeah, coffee. Give me a second. Oh man, okay. Oh, and I need to do. Where is it? Okay. Need to put in my subs. Add donation. Subscribers. $85. $85 in subscriptions, which you guys rock. Da-da-da, subscribers. And then I need to spell bank times two. 170 goes in the spell bank, which with Bird's donation is going to bring us up to. Hey, New Titans, how you doing? Hey, thanks for the host, Kaboomski. Appreciate it. I wish there was a way to adjust that volume a little bit more. Bridian! Thanks, Bridian. That'd be awesome. We'll share it for sure. Try something. This might be loud. Actually, let me do this. Trying to get my music to be louder, but not deafen my players. I don't know exactly how to do that. Because, yeah, I bet you guys can barely hear the music, right? Out there in the world. Yeah, I'm sure you guys can barely hear the music. No, I'm sharing it through through Zoom so my players can hear it as well. But unfortunately, I can't figure out a way to... They're getting deafened by it if I turn it up any higher. And I don't know how to turn that down... Because it's a new feature that they've put in there. So anyway, I don't know. Trying to think of another way around it. Well, no other way. Because I just don't know, I don't think I can adjust. I'm gonna have to play on it some other time. I might stop sharing with them so I've got music for the stream, because I think they prefer not to have it. So yeah, I think I'm gonna stop sharing music with them so you guys can have music. Because for them, it's kind of sometimes distracting to try to talk over top of it. I'm gonna work on it some when I get a chance. So now you guys should start having music. Help me out with my mix today, guys. I want it to be audible, but not overpowering, which usually I keep that at about the -35, -35, -30-ish area for in the desktop audio OBS. So we'll do that, and I will talk, because right now it's just background. I've just got a little bit of background stuff going on. I'm gonna have to work out how to do, well, oh, I know how to do it. I need to do prep work to do it, though. Yeah, that's the problem. But it still gets to be a pain in the butt. I will figure it out. The problem is, yeah, I don't know. I'm not going to worry about it. We need to get started because, well, I'm still missing a player that I was expecting to have. Who am I missing? I'm missing a Kyle. Hey, Viridian, you're slacking on your job here. if he's around, get him up. We're going to get started. Go ahead and get introductions going while we're waiting on Kyle. I will be right with you guys.
Who popped up on Twitter and was like, ah,
but I'm see, I had everything ready for a 7 cam and now we're in a 6 cam mode. Ugh.
It does definitely seem up my ass.
Kyle.
I just.
What are you doing, buddy? Haven't. So here we are. We are live and I need to get people in their right spots because I was thinking I was going to have 7 players. I assume that I'm going to get one eventually, though. So, anyway, I was going to say, Kyle's like got things going on this episode and stuff.
So burning stuff question.
And things.
What's with the hair?
It's for San Diego.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, it's for San Diego Comic Con. Yeah.
Yuck.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, he's looking sly, man. But anyway, let me even think who I've got labels for. Good night. Hey, look, there was an Axel hiding. So let's start with Axel. Templar Warden, who are you? Tell us about yourself.
I am Templar Warden. I am playing the Tabaxi Wizard hidden by Axel, the eccentric, crazy, not crazy, eccentric, energetic, not a lich Tabaxi Wizard.
Totally not a lich.
And, you know, he's got a whole city of new experiences to explore, so this is gonna be fine.
Gonna be fine. No trouble to be gotten into here. None at all. Next up,
libraries.
Yes, libraries. Let's next go up with our buddy Tunarth.
Hello, I am Tunarth in chat. I'm playing Kel the Wood Elf Druid, who is probably the most miserable right now of this entire batch of adventurers.
Potentially.
We're so close, though.
Close to what, though? That's the question.
They're fine here as far as the music volume, but it's hard to hear the cast above it. Okay. Guys, talk for me. Someone talk?
Hello, how's it going? Tall Squall dyed his hair.
Yep.
We're not quite sure why.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my darling. Hello, my dad.
Yes, for those going to San Diego Comic-Con, you will find out. All the good stuff. So, anyway.
Still checking things here. I'm going to mumble a little bit. Chat, let us know if that's any better.
Yeah. I'm voting that. Okay, yeah. Keep talking for me, Bird.
I am Bird versus Plane. Okay. It's great. It's a great day to be alive.
There we go.
Great.
Great. Totally great. Okay. So, cool. We will continue on with Bird versus Plane.
Just muted my mic. Hey, I'm Bird versus Plane. I'll be playing Iskatol, the half-elf bard turned gunslinger, whose nemesis is here, supposedly, in Sojourns, who has some bardic duties to take care of, who has a guy who knows about Qualverine to go talk. There's a lot going on in this damn city.
There's quite a bit. Next up, we have Good Guy Pie.
Hello, everyone. I am Good Guy Pie. It's good to be back. How are you? I'm happy. I've come off a train of just good thoughts and good times, and we're here playing all the way from High Mount. Look, Gold Heart Adventure Extraordinaire, and I switched up the introduction, so I don't have anything to say after that.
And you're not from High Mount.
I'm not from High Mount. It's Elevation Pit. What am I from?
Okay, so I think I might have myself adjusted now. And the players adjusted, and the music adjusted, and we will see how that all goes. My gain might be turned up, have been turned up a little bit, but I think I've got us taken care of now. I'm off my game. Luna, NG9 is not gone on yet.
You saved the best for last.
I saved the best for last.
Hello, lovely audience. Have you missed me? I missed you. I'm NG9, and I play Luna, our Water Genasi monk cleric, who is going to get to the lay of the land before she goes and destroys all those church people. Hashtag no context.
Hashtag no context. Our context, yes. Anyway, Actually, I'm going to turn it back over to NNG9 because we are run our channel 100% for charity. And this month, Luna, our NNG9, Alicia, is going to tell us a little bit about Pathways to Safety. And that's
Thank you. Yes, this month's charity is Pathways to Safety International, an organization dedicated to providing services to people abroad, U.S. citizens abroad who experience domestic violence. It can happen anywhere to anyone. They provide anything from relocation services to transition, just counseling, legal advice, a lot of good information on the website. Please feel free to go ahead and check it out. Although if you are not on a computer that you deem safe from your abuser, please go to a public place, access it, and make the call from there. But yeah, please, if you feel so inclined, go ahead and check out the website. Or if you'd like to donate through our channel, you can go ahead and check out the levels below. You can give us luck dice, advantages, items. Shop below.
Okay, I think I figured it out. I had turned down my headphone speakers in Zoom. And I think now we've got our players with a little bit more oomph behind them.
You got to make sure the pro streamer box is checked.
Yep.
Whenever
pro
you get
streamer.
Started.
I'm kind of like, a bleach blonde now, so I've forgotten how to stream.
You haven't worn your hat in a while either. You need to break.
Yeah, that's what
again.
The problem is. I need to bring back the hat. Pro streamer hat, pro streamer t-shirt. I need to like get completely decked out in all the pro streamer stuff. And speaking of announcements, I'm actually going to turn it over to Bird versus Plane for an announcement that we did this week.
We'll keep this short and sweet so we can get to that nice and juicy vice action. But we announced Bird in the Storm, a new publishing adventure between Tall Squall and myself, coming out with D&D and other RPG modules. And we are going to debut our work in progress of our first one at Gen Con. So if anyone's available or coming to Gen Con, we'll have some work in progress stuff to hand out. We'll have some ribbons and potentially some merch and stuff. And we are so excited to get started on this adventure. We'll also have our digital playtest available here pretty soon. Here is a link to a tweet that kind of has all that information in one spot. But yeah, guys, a lot of that's just from the support of you all and how damn inspiring each and every one of you has been in our lives. So thank you for the support in this and throughout everything altogether.
Absolutely. So hope to see you guys at Gen Con. More to give you just a little bit of a preview. Our first module does take place in this world of the Vice, but at a different time. So when different things were acting in the world. So hopefully you guys who enjoy our little show here, we'll find some enjoyment in that. But there's also going to be things that are not related to this world that will be coming as well. In fact, some really interesting things that our buddy Bird is cooking up that I know I'm looking forward to as well, to see the craziness he's going to take us on. Anyway, with that, let's jump back into where we were when we last were with our party, having made it out of the somewhat troubling Raven Rock Vineyards. Troubling for some, more troubling
somewhat?
For others.
Somewhat?
Somewhat troubling
really?
For some, more troubling for others. Dude, it was so bad. It turned my hair white. I mean, it was crazy. So after making it out of there, interesting evening spent at the Sanctuary Stone and then finishing up their journey outward, they came to Falcon's Crest. Across the plateau in the distance, this giant capital city of the humans perched upon the top of the plateau that they have been making their way across, looking down over the Misty Moon Valley, and with hopes of all many answers and hopefully just as many questions and hopefully with some answers as well lying ahead for pretty much each and every party member, they made their way to the city two wagon loads full of whiskey that they had recovered for the Linfert Distillery, their buddy Wallace down below, and a third wagon that was filled with charitable donations and some of their equipment that they were bringing along with them as well to potentially get back to their proper owners down at the Tangled Braids orphanage and within the city as well. They were told that they'd be met by some woman, which they in fact were, a bespectacled, sort of uptight, skinny man in very formal attire, met them as they came into the first citadel that sort of is at the head of Falcon's Crest, sort of built into one side of this city that is walled, but not walled in a traditional way. The outer wall is actually residences, these huge sort of monolithic castles that are all joined together to make this outer bulwark that is the walls of the cities. They butt right up to the actual stone and masonry walls that are the citadel. If you sort of imagine an octagon with a smaller octagon pushed up all the way up against one of its walls, that's sort of an idea of how this city is built, the smaller octagon being the citadel that they came into. Within that citadel area, they saw a large customs area and sort of a makeshift market for people who couldn't make it through, pay their taxes or pay their dues to get into the actual city, but still wanted to move some of their wares, sort of a peasant's market. But they were met quite quickly by this gentleman. There was a little bit of side-eyeing of trying to identify each other, as the party does not look all the same way that Wallace met them down below. And the party wasn't quite sure what to expect. Upon determining their identity, the gentleman basically first took the reins, but I believe we eventually had him hop up on the front wagon to take the reins, plop down what looked like a half platinum piece onto the tariff, the little tariff console that was set up at these gates that led out into the main part of this citadel. As they sort of rounded around this sort of inner wall of the citadel into what would be the true courtyard of the citadel, they found their first large cistern stone, a 50 to 60 foot high stone, similar to the ones that they had seen collecting fog and creating water throughout their journey across the Misty Moon Valley and across the Raven Rock Vineyards. This one much larger, an abstract sculpture depicting a shield and a blade that stuck high into the ground, ancient and cracked and weathered. It was identified to them as the sword and shield cistern stone by the person leading them, as he then took them around to the far side of the stone. The sounds of blacksmiths and industry, chisels and stoneworking, sort of heavy commerce and crafting happening within this area. Definitely a huge presence of the Talon Guard inside the citadel, looking a little bit more well-kept, well-groomed, same uniforms that they experienced down below, but not sort of the folks who are out in the field. These are sort of the city guard of the Talon Guard who were in representation here. And as they got past the cistern stone, we're going to go ahead and pick back up in our narrative before continuing out in the city. We had gone a little bit further last time, but since we've got two of our players who weren't here last time, I'm going to check in with them as they enter into this citadel and see this cistern stone and are beginning their journey across. Luna having been disguised by Iska. So Iska, how did you disguise Luna this time as you played your song?
I think I would have asked her, what would Luna have wanted to look like?
Huh. probably describe probably like a woman in her mid-50s, short brown hair, sort of, you know, kind of got the skin color where it's like she's tan from like working in the sun and all that. Simple clothing.
So kind of like a simple, like, not field hand, but, you know, like someone who, like you described, like someone who's working like pretty consistently and everything. So not of like grand nobility or anything, but can get a, like, through the city, no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Nondescript woman.
Human, half-elven, as those are the two major races that you easily would have identified as you were coming into the city.
Human? Yeah.
Sure.
You think so?
Works for me.
And we will take a second here to introduce Dragons or Cats, our Australian, coming to us from tomorrow morning at 4 a.m. How you doing, buddy?
My microphone's really cold. Hi, I am Dragons Are Sick and Cold, but it's very nice to see you all again. I'll be playing Vidar Lycrin, the Moon Elf. It's an adjustment. Moon Elf Hexblade. And it's going to get interesting, I think. It's going to be fun.
For those of you who didn't tune in last time, Kyle's normal character, Iskrin, is no longer with us for the time being, as his magical sword, Lysithia, has become his new patron, and he is no longer as a patron of the Frost Prince, but currently is bound and sworn to Lysithia, his magical blade at his side.
My best friend.
And you say temporary, but realistically, he said it would last a month from new moon to new moon. So we're probably looking at well into next year, right?
We will see. Yeah, no, there's a lot to do in Falcon's Crest. So other than that, anything else people want to be doing as they have passed through sort of the customs point and are still within this large citadel? It seems as though at one point probably was a very military-based citadel, but now has been taken over by a lot of commerce, a lot of, again, shops, blacksmiths, wagon crafters, basically a lot of sort of the heavy artisans sort of the city seem to have basically put themselves here close to the main entrance, certainly as sometimes that is where their services would be required. The sound of smithing and sulfur in the air, the smell of sulfur in the air, as I was saying, as you swing around.
Just real quick, the hat is low. The Arcana Mystica sash is not visible.
Okay.
It's 'cause it's not supposed to be here yet, so.
Very good.
And as a reminder, I had gotten the cloak, the hooded cloak, and I'm sitting in the second wagon with the cloak, with the hood up.
Yep. Yeah.
And that was Luna's old cloak?
It's Luna's old cloak. We were trying to think. I think that you kept your cloak when you bought your new one all the way back at Liam's caravan. If you didn't, you did now.
No, I did.
Yeah.
And Luna, while we're going through like sections of the city, is definitely going to be asking for names, and she has kind of like her pad out and the sketch and some stuff.
Okay. So this gentleman who's been leading you has not introduced himself yet to you. But as you start asking questions, as he was correcting Vidar on the name of the sword and shield, Luna can pipe up and ask about the facility. He says, this is Greymont Citadel. It's one of the first structures of the human settlement here on the plateau before the city grew around it.
Greymont Citadel, right?
Greymont, yes. Certainly Axel, Iska, and Vidar will recognize the Greymont name as being the name of the historical monarchy of Falcon's Crest before it died out.
Yeah, it's the guy that got the sword. Hence the sword and shit. From the Falamega. Is that what they call themselves? I don't know.
So, the party continues out of this bustling yard, the sounds around them, the sword and shield cistern stone sort of drifting behind them. Ringing of metal again in the air. You can see there is a cut sort of in front of you, directly across from where the gate would be, even though there is a wall in between that separates out the customs area. And you see a pathway that dives down into the ground that this gentleman starts leading your carts toward. It does seem to be fairly heavily trafficked. There are, again, shops and other things built up right to where this cut is. And as you turn the corner, you see it descends downward while the ground level stays the same to either side. Similar to like when you go under a tunnel and under an overpass type idea. As the walls get higher as you go down, you actually can see what looks like day laborers and merchants and even kids sort of sitting on the edge angles, their feet dangling over, eating meat pies, drinking some ale, as it is late in the evening now. The workday is coming to a close. The sun, as we said, it's about 6:30. The sun is getting lower in the sky. You keep descending down through this. You see these just sheer, solid rock walls where this has been, you know, dug out and carved in. Luck, with his mining experience, can see marks from pickaxes and other things that dug this this road. And actually, instead of there being a gate out of this side of Greymont Citadel, this actually seems to go under the wall itself, down below the foundations. The ground level above, as you pass deeper and deeper, the wall is getting higher until you're 10, 15, getting closer to 20 feet down. You can see sort of the back sides of some shops that are built right up to it. Others actually have built stone, you know, freestanding stone walls that go higher, sort of making courtyards that you can't see into. As you go by, you can hear sort of a loud cheer from one place. Sounds like might be a tavern or an inn where people are getting some drink after their days of labor. As you get almost 25 feet down, you can see above you, looming towards you, the wall. This huge, massive structure that you had passed through the gates of. You know it's close to 50, 60 feet thick. And you dive down under it and the path flattens out. Here there are torches. They don't seem to be smoking. Axel, having seen these before, are probably ever-burning torches. Magically lit. You do see next to each one of them, there's also a small fixture that has a egg-shaped stone next to it that has small runes into it. No magical energy glowing from it at this point, but similar in structure to the cistern stones that you had seen down below. You guys know how the fog does come in across the top of the plateau, potentially at nighttime when the torches are less effective. This happens to pull fog out of the air to allow illumination to sort of get a little deeper through the fog. As you travel about the 50 feet underneath of the wall, you see that ahead, the path does not seem to go back up. It stays at this level as though this next section of the city is at a different level than the citadel was built at. And as you come emerge out, you do see, in fact, there is no elevation. The rest of the city lies sort of below and before you. The walls, the outside walls of the citadel is just going off at right angles, leaving you with not terribly elevated view, but enough view that you can get a bit of the layout of the city immediately around you. Of course, the first thing that you notice are these huge monolithic residences that now you can see encircle this entire sort of basin of the city. huge 5-6 story tall structures with steeply steeply canted roofs that are, extend another sometimes 1-2 stories into the air with gabled windows in them, of these large external structures, and then in front of you throughout smaller structures, 1-story, 2-story, 3-story homes. The biggest thing that you notice is from this vantage point, most of them are row houses and seem to all be adjoining each other, seem to be connected together throughout the city, making almost a dizzying maze. From up here, you can get a little bit of a layout to it, but again, you're probably only 1 story up. A lot of these are 2 stories. So for the most part, you're just getting a kind of impression. This city is very densely packed, heavily populated. You are surrounded by people as you are flowing out from the citadel and into the city proper. To your right, you do see the outer wall of the citadel, the sheer stone wall, and it curves back away from you. You can sort of follow the outer wall of the citadel turning back to make its own sort of structure there. Directly across from it, though, there is a road. So you can see, following that curve, a road, and along that road, some of these row houses. Exactly uniform, one to the next, all connected. Most of them have a stairway that goes up to them. To give you a modern reference, this is very much like brownstones that you would see in sort of older cities, type idea. You have a staircase that leads up to a first level where there's a door. These are all very uniform. For the most part, construction here is made out of this gray granite stone. And as the road curves back around following the wall, these houses curve back around too until you lose them in sight as it goes actually downhill to your left and you see it sort of disappear in these just reoccurring row houses to your left-hand side. To your right-hand side, once you get past the wall of the citadel, you can sort of see how it curves away, but the ground stays there. There is a whole shelf that you can see over to your right that is at the same elevation as the ground level of the citadel. So it is about 20 feet, 25 feet higher than you. It's a sheer cliff that leads up to there. There are houses below it between you and that cliff, but you can still see the top of it. And the biggest thing you notice up on the top of that cliff are towers. Incredibly thin towers of stone, arches that sort of leap from tower to tower, many buttresses, flying buttresses up supporting them, very ornate structures that almost seem hard to believe would exist out of just natural mason work up on this area to your right-hand side. And in front of you, you see a huge road, wider than what you just came out of. In fact, it splits out to become a wider thoroughfare. Large, mostly 3-4-story houses here. Not as big as the monoliths on the outer row, but on either side of this, very large structures that line this road in front of you. And as you take a look at it, you see it's actually 2 roads, side by side, that has what almost looks like a rock garden running through the middle of it. You see that on the right-hand side of the road, all of the traffic is moving in the same direction that you are, and the left-hand road, all of it is moving the opposite direction. Quite ingenious, really, separating the two ways of traffic. The rock gardens in between seem to be places where people gather. Gardens, there are little kiosks there. People seem to be just gathered among these rock gardens in their center. And you can see here again, as evening, the end of the workday seems to be coming to end, you see many people walking along the roads. Again, as you had heard, horses and wagons up on the plateau and in Falcon's Crest are fairly rare. So for the most part, you're seeing pedestrians. You see once in a while people on interesting, Iska would call them clockwork contraptions, but they are not nearly of the ornateness that she is familiar with. They are these wheeled structures that people seem to be pedaling that give them locomotion, as bicycles are. A few people are riding bicycles of an older style. It is an incredibly cosmopolitan area. People are well-dressed, well-groomed. While not in open display, your eye can catch little pieces of magic that people might be using as they are navigating. And as you look down there, your guide pauses for a moment, sort of waiting for an opening for him to merge in to be able to hop on this large road.
I had a question.
Yep.
As we were coming down that ramp that went under the wall,
mm-hmm.
Did I get the sense that, was it carved, that was that ramp like carved out of the stone to go down, or was that ramp natural and then they built up across it? Or, I mean, I'm...
Do me a nature check.
Nature.
The biggest thing, because luck would have been pointing them out, you saw the marks of it being carved. However, he also notes, that monumental of an excavation probably had some natural feature that was expanded upon, much as you do in the mines.
Okay, that's what I was wondering. Thanks.
So, you guys are sort of looking out upon the city as your guide takes you. Any impressions or things you want to...
I also want to ask, because we had, gotten a fair way into the city at the end last time, and we had passed the place, and I had asked and had it pointed out to me the place where I need to go to deliver my letter.
Mm-hmm.
Where we are right now... Is that before we got to
it's
that,
before,
or have we
it's
passed?
Before we got there. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I just kind of wanted to relive this a little bit for Iska and Luna's sake. But yes, your question still stands, and I will point it out as you make it to there. So, we can just, I know, the lots of information. We can just continue on.
Kel is doing nothing but, keeping his head down. And feeling miserably uncomfortable and awful.
So, how many people did it take to do the whole carving?
He sort of looks at you strangely. I don't think it's measured in people as measured in generations. This city has been... There's been human settlement on this site for time immemorial, but... the city is forever evolving. The most current incarnation, certainly after the Sylvan War, which has been 2,000 years in the making and longer, as there were fortifications here prior to the Sylvan War that even last now till today. Millennia that Falcon's Crest has stood here. Some say the Citadel... Even longer, since time before time.
How many generations then?
Hundreds. Depending on whose generations you're talking about. You have to remember, the last 2,000 years of our history was shaped somewhat by the elves who came to assist us.
It's a bit hard to comprehend. I come from a small town, a very small town. So, and we're kind of a mining town, so this is a scale that is kind of hard to comprehend. Just a bit.
Well, you're not the only one, but I assume your mines were there... Probably first just a hole in the ground, right?
Yeah.
And then became so much more. And after years and years and built upon and built upon, became a whole network, right? Some's right. Abandoned, some still active. That is Falcon's Crest. But imagine it going back... as long as anyone can remember. Yes.
This is out of character question. You said we saw a lot of humans and half-elves.
Humans and half-elves certainly are the major race here. It would not take long to spot most every other race that you have encountered.
Okay, I was just curious if we were still seeing a decent amount of elves or not, because we know that the elves helped build this place.
I would say the third most populous would be actual true elves. You will notice that most of the elves here bear more of a resemblance to Vidar than to Cilia. However, both high elven in feature. So it is mainly a moon elven populace here, not a sun elf populace.
So Iska will raise her hand for the tour guide, I guess.
Yeah.
And say, these elves who helped build it, I've come across a word to describe them lately, and I don't know if it's what its significance is or if it's even appropriate to use anymore, but, and she will like lean in close and like whisper, this fair Malagar, is that who we're referring to?
His eyebrows pop up. That's his a charged word. He sort of smiles at you in a somewhat condescending way. It is not used in polite company.
Iska will turn to Ishgrin. Sorry, Vidar. And say, like, maybe back off on using that so freely, yeah?
The histories would... and scholars could tell you more about the full history, but know that to most elves and half-elves, it is a stain on their past, a debt they feel is owed. And to call it up is... He just sort of looks at you, not, you know, almost with that, not quite finding the word of uncomfortable he comes up with.
So you're talking about like, sorry. So you're talking about histories and stuff. You, there's libraries here.
Of course.
Where are they?
Well, which type of library? He points up to that sort of ridge over that had the tall towers on it. That was sort of up at the same level of the citadel, but outside the citadel's wall. He goes, well, the Arcane Terrace is where the magical libraries all lie. You have histories that are mainly in Sentinel Row, as they are keepers of the diplomacy and the laws. For those of more... he sort of rolls his eyes a little bit of more fiction, historical fictions. Certainly there are bookstores and other... oddities that can be found in the Wynwood Terrace, where we're headed.
Historical fictions? So they're written down stuff that's not real?
Well, no. Plays. Stories. Based off of history.
Okay.
Most of the arts you can find there at the... down in the Wynwood Terrace.
Okay, so the Arcane Terrace, Sentinel Row, and then the Wynwood Terrace are sort of fictions.
I've got the wrong name. It's the Arcane Terrace. It's not the Wynwood Terrace.
Okay, so Arcane Terrace, Sentinel Row, and something else.
Sorry. Wynwood Basin. I'm sorry. The Wynwood Basin. Okay. I'm like, wait a second. I know Terrace isn't right because the Wynwood Basin.
Up, middle, down. Yeah, that makes
sense. Yes.
Okay. Are there generally like restrictions? Because you like Sentinel Row for Matt say, you said they were very picky about letting people in. Is there something similar for the Arcane Terrace? Maybe.
Yes, Sentinel Row is where the embassies are located and many of the diplomatic missions. It is open to the public, but of course you will have to pass through the guards and declare any weapons, magical items, so that they can be properly cataloged and made sure that they don't pose a threat to anyone within.
All right. And that's the same for the Arcane Terrace?
The Arcane Terrace can be a bit more problematic. The Arcana Mystica controls access to the Arcane Terrace.
Ah. Okay.
And while we're asking, the Windward Basin as well?
So, Grey Talon Citadel, you've heard, the Arcane Terrace, Sentinel Row, Windward Basin. Making sure that I've got, yeah.
All right.
And you've heard of Matron Square as well. Not yet by from your this tour guide, but previously, when you asked about temples, Luna.
Vidar would have, when Isco looked back at Vidar, he would have just shrugged and mouthed to her, "That's not me." And then hearing about the libraries and stories as well, after Axel, their conversation finishes and moves on, Vidar would lean in and ask, will basically say, "I wouldn't mind tagging along with you if you want to go later on today or tonight or something. I'm sure there could be some information, and I guess I fit in around here. Strangely."
Well, I mean...
I mean, well, else I we find...
We have kind of a... But yeah, this is, we're going to be here for a bit, so I think I'm going to visit the library at some point. Obviously, but probably first.
Indeed, yeah. Sorry, but attacked by a cat. Dragon. Oh, ow. Especially music.
Because it was deafening you guys in order for the stream to hear it, let me get you guys something then.
Sorry. Thank you.
Yeah, let me. I'm probably going to put you back on roll 20 music.
It's like every session now, once we begin, Kevin just decides to snuggle up and then has at it with swords and spears. It's adorable.
But there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, your little personal dragon.
And little smog.
Dragons, man.
Hey, dragons. Uh-huh. What can you do? Uh-huh. Right? What can you do? I will get you guys some music. Give me half a second so we can get back on story. Where did it go? Good Lord. All I've got is my scary music.
It's all right. Joy. The scary music.
I mean, there's the Arcana Mystica and the Temple Purity around. Pretty sure it's
There's always time for scary music.
And all the Master Dragon as well.
Yeah, you know, just that stuff. I mean, you don't really aren't really worried about that stuff, right? You know, it's not going to be that bad.
Like, Vidal's not going to ask at all about what the deal is with the Oracle or the Eladrin, or why they even want it.
What's an Eladrin?
Exactly. No tea, no shade, no pink lemonade.
Yeah. So, there you go. So as you guys are there going across, Luna, because you said you were asking, this gentleman points out to you, he goes, this area here is known as the Stonewood Rush. It is the main thoroughfare through the city. And as I was saying, you see well-dressed residents in this area. Many seem to be coming back from business. These do not seem to be the crafters and laborers necessarily that you saw up above up above in the Citadel. These seem much more finely dressed, as though they probably are working in shops or other places. You do see these homes that you had noticed before. They're all connected together. But where that one section that you saw that went off down to the left were very uniform in size, structure, width, here they are all very different in construction. Some are four-story next to some that are two-story. All very ornate in their construction. Some, you know, take up, you know, by counting windows, will be 8 or 10 sets of windows long. Others will only be 2, but then will be 5 stories high. They have different ornamentation on the outside of them, sometimes different colors on the outside, that their rock work, this gray rock work, has been stained. You can still see the rock through it, but it seems to be of, have some kind of coloration to it. Every few, probably about every 50 feet or so, you do see a tall pole that has a large one of these eggs with runes on top of it, sort of like a ostrich egg. You're getting into the night, Vidar does not see a thing that surrounds those. As you move forward, Axel, do me a investigation check, just as your Axel. I'll say Iska can as well.
So lucky that Axel hopped on the cart, because he would be probably getting lost at this point.
Yeah.
Distractions.
Axel, as you look up and sort of are inspecting these houses, you see that the doors and windows here, they all, you've seen this kind of construction in books before, but you had always had them associated to be leaded panels that had glass in them. What you see here are stone-shaped frames around panes of glass. So the reality is, you know, while it is like a stained glass window, but instead of it being leaded, they have been, the filigree and the framing has all been done with live stone, single pieces of live stone, creating both the doors and the windows of both of these, often in very intricate designs, some more simple, that'd just be square panes, but for the most part along this street, it seems to be one of the few things that sets some of the houses apart is the intricacy of the window work and the door work. Iska, on your 18, you notice atop many of these structures carved stone gargoyles that look down upon the streets, both sides of the street looking down upon the stoneward rush. As you move forward, you notice, you know, where there are actual cuts in the buildings that mark blocks that sort of then cut off to the sides. These areas seem to, the center section, this center garden area sort of bulges out to sort of make it a little bit wider. You can see that the corner buildings all here seem to be sort of like private gathering areas. Many of them have stone walls around them, some with outdoor sort of seating areas. Other obviously have big glass windows. Seem to be, you would think, public places, but many of them seem to have doorways that have a attendant at them, not necessarily letting just anybody in.
Are these the gargoyles you mentioned, are they just stone statues now, or do they appear to be like, because in one of the readings that we found, there were like swarms of gargoyles that were sentient that protected Falcon's Crest. So
you can't tell. You don't know.
Okay.
But exactly what you said with your histories. I mean, Iska can say it in character if you'd like, regarding what you all had read. That.
Oh yeah, she will point out to the party. Then she'll just look up while they're traveling and point out some of the gargoyles and bring up the text that Axel and Vidar and I read mentioned that these used to protect the city, that these were once alive. But maybe they still are.
Well, I think some people down at the left mentioned it as well, about the city and the walls and everything, so I don't know. I mean,
I think Isfrin did to be see any spots that
should have gargoyles, but gargoyles are absent.
On your investigation of 25, I'll say you see places that gargoyles could perch, and there's nothing there, but there's not something specifically that looks like it is empty gargoyle spot.
Maybe. Why wouldn't they? The only reason they wouldn't be because of the, you know. So, yeah. Probably. Unless you're not those spots there, and he points out the spots that could have gargoyles. Unless those spots there are being emptied. But, I doubt it. Don't mess with anything, then, I guess.
Ishkrin did see on the lift ride up the signatures of the, what's it called, the gargoyles.
Yep. You guys all did on the lifts as you were going by, passed by many, both things that looked like weathered down gargoyles and some that looked like they were fresh carved in the walls.
And Ishkrin remembers seeing their like magical signature. Would Vidar remember that?
You have all of Ishkrin's memories.
Excellent. Oh god, they're all unlocked at once.
Not all of his current life memories.
Okay. Yeah. That's lucky.
So you travel along the Stoneward Rush for 20-25 minutes, and it's really, you realize that perspective in this city is very weird because of these sort of long corridors of buildings. And you've been traveling for 25 minutes, and until you look behind you, you don't even realize how far you've come, because it doesn't look like you've made it very long down this street. But you do notice at this point, after passing only about two or three cross streets, that the left side of the street, opposite what would be across the garden, other lane of traffic, and then the far side, you begin to start seeing a very huge three-story wall with no doors, leaves barely a sidewalk left on the other side. It's built right up to the Stoneward Rush. And parts of the walls have regular sort of very small square windows. They are very Spartan in their decor, just to let light in. And other parts have these sort of huge vaulted alcoves that are inlaid with colored glass, stained glass, still done with the stonework. And after that wall stretching for about a block, the left-hand side of the street opens up into a huge open courtyard. And sitting in the middle of it, you see another one of these cistern stones. It is, again, almost 60 feet tall. It is almost teardrop in shape, except with the top sort of bent over to one side. And down towards the bottom of it, you can see what looks to be a smaller teardrop-shaped foam stone that is sort of inlaid into it. Again, very much abstract in nature, but your guide points this out as the Matron Stone, and this is Matron Square. You can see, as Luna has done some studying into religion, you can see symbols of different gods that you are familiar with. Some most facing into the square. There are other smaller structures sort of obscured and behind them. The big ones that you do pick out, Luna, you pick out the symbol of Hieronius. You pick out, do me a religion check to see, we'll see how many more you pick out.
Sure. I will go ahead and use an advantage.
Okay.
I want to know.
Can Axel be taking a look around and picking out to see if there are any that he recognizes?
We'll give that a D4. So give me a D4, see how many more you know. Oh. As you're passing by, you do see. I'm trying to think of where you're from. I think we'll go with this one. You see a large temple almost straight across from the matron stone from where you are. So it'd be, you know, the far side of the square, sort of like deep in the alcove of Ayun, the knowing mistress. I would also say Axel would recognize that one as well. You are somewhat distracted, Luna, and why you didn't be able to pick out more, because your guide points out across from Matron's Square, almost directly across from, at a right angle to where the stone is in the center of this square. So almost if you had a concave structure, stone is in the center, straight out from what would be the center of it, a road that goes for only about 100 yards before there is a large gate and two large curved of these sort of monolithic outer buildings, but this is deep into the city, and he points out that that is the entrance and the gateway into Sentinel Row. And you can see the gates are closed at this time, and there is a heavy Talon Guard presence there at the main gates. All of y'all can do me a perception check as you sort of look through these big wrought iron open metal gates.
Just a question. What's the temperature like? Is it warm? Is it cold?
It is cooler up here on top of the plateau. It is cooler. It just as general as cities are a little bit warmer, but as the sun goes down, it will become cooler. And you know from last night, out in the vineyard, once the fog comes in, it is that damp cold that seeps into your bones. Not freezing, but just that uncomfortable, you wish you had a jumper or two type idea.
Bedar wishes he had a jumper because he's still in his tattered, crappy shirt and wearing boots. And I don't even think he put
on... sort of torn up trousers. It's nothing special.
Yeah, he's not even wearing shoes.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, he's full of her.
Luck, almost as though your eyes are drawn to it. Through the gateway, far in the distance, you can see another one of these large stones, these large cistern stones. This one is wide at the base. It actually looks like two stones, as though it's been cracked in half, that then twist and connect together to the top of it. And your guide points out what he calls the split stone, which is another one of the main cistern stones of the city that serves Sentinel Row.
What do they do? The split stone thing.
Water. There is no water on the plateau. We have to collect it from the fog. The cistern stones pull the water from the fog and provide water for the city. There are six in total. Plus
and do they,
all the smaller
do
ones.
They,
big public ones.
Are they just means of also identifying which districts you're in?
As well, most districts are associated with this stone somewhat. It became convenient, and so that's their names lost to the early history, the true names. They've sort of adopted these common names.
Thanks for that. I am trying my best to take notes, so clarification always helps.
Yeah. So yeah, so far you know that the Matron Stone is in Matron Square, the Split Stone down on Sentinel Row, and the Sword and the Shield up in. And I said it wrong before. I said it was the Greymont. It's the Grey Talon Citadel, which was originally the Greymont Citadel.
Just like Sojourn.
Sorry. Yes.
Axel,
I can't go. I can't have a city without me having a name that I change that I'm never going to change in my brain.
So Axel's sort of going to scramble over the carts and arts. Is it unusual to have that many guards, or is that because everyone's getting ready for moving?
Oh, Sentinel Row is always has many patrols and many of the Talon Guard present. Again, we have many dignitaries, and as the solstice approaches, and as the contingent will be leaving soon after to go to the conclave, we have many visiting dignitaries in town.
So is it locked off to common folk now? Or?
Oh, just for the evening. As the fog comes in, they basically keep it closed off. But there's always, you are always able to see your representatives within Sentinel Row. It's part of our culture.
Yeah, okay. All right, well.
Don't you guys start. I see what you're doing in chat. Don't you do it. Don't you do
it. What
does
it mean?
Rocks fall. We are on a big stone. We are on a big stone plateau. I will push your ass off. all it takes is a stiff breeze up here.
So Axel sort of commented, "Oh, we'll probably have to come back tomorrow. Then we want to get in to see somebody, perhaps." Okay.
Yes. So as it is, again. It's been almost 30 minutes getting to this point, and as, it does not seem as though you've gotten that much closer to your destination. In fact, it takes a good 10 minutes to actually cross in front of Matron Square and this entry to Sentinel Row. And as you do get to the far side of Matron Square, you do notice that the road in front of you, the houses begin to get smaller, less ornate in their structure, and you see that the road again begins to cut downward through the rock, and as you seem to be going down to a lower area, and a lot of the structures here have gone transitioned now on either side of the road, transitioned from sort of these more formal affairs to sort of more, I'll call them bohemian, a little bit more artistic, I'm telling you, right off the edge. We're going to a place called the Overhang District. Don't tempt me. anyway, you guys continue forward, and your guide takes you further down, into this area, and with Luna, it's him seeing her being diligently taking notes and trying to draw a map, goes, and this is the Windwood Basin. As you move forward, you see the basin lying before you, but you see the road sort of takes a fairly sharp turn to the right as it sort of curves down the side, as for it to go straight down into the basin would be far too steep for wagons or even for people to traverse. So it swings way to the right and sort of hugs across again another cliff face that brings you down to this new lower level. The thing that you're noticing most as you swing around here is... in front of you, you see the giant monolithic walls of these outer structures, these outer residences of Falcon's Crest. And in this area, you see daylight shining what would be underneath of them. And you see arched structures underneath of them as the basin seems to actually go underneath of this outer wall. It is filled with shops. You see lots of more revelers. Iska, you will notice that it is teeming with music and sort of just this sense of entertainment and life.
What kind of music? Like a wide selection of music, or we got some like Falinari BS going
actually
on?
Here it is much more similar to some of the musics that you heard back down with the folks at the Arbor Leafs. It is
awesome. Iska goes acoustic. I can get down with some folk rock.
Yeah. I can't remember if that's the music that I want to have. Yeah, that works. So yeah, as you enter into this part of the city, it is a much more lively atmosphere. You see taverns, you see pubs, you see sort of a more evidence of sort of the common folk of this area. And you know, it's now 7:30 at night. The fog is not rolled in yet. It is the last of light upon the area. And this area that you're in now, still inside of the outer structures, is teeming with life. There are street vendors who are yelling out check to roll 20 muted or refresh. Oh yeah, I've got music playing in roll 20, guys, if you're not hearing it. You see street vendors, you see lots and lots of folks just truly having after work, folks yelling from windows to windows on the second floor. You still see these structures all connected together. It is very much as though it is rows of houses and shops and other type things. And you keep following the road and getting closer and closer to this sort of outer group, this outer wall of these monolithic residences, and find yourselves being led underneath of them. Basically through large archways of heavy stone structure, and you can see out in front of you as you pass through just open blue sky. And as you emerge the other side, Iska, you will recognize a structure like this almost immediately. It is an amphitheater with seats that face back towards now the outer wall of these residences. And as you look up, you can see terraces all across this that look down into what your guide now tells you is the Overhang District, the entertainment district of Falcon's Crest.
Does seeing this amphitheater or any of this place cause any flashbacks to that vision I had way, 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 like episode like 5 of being on stage and a bunch of people, I think, laughing?
Do a history check.
I'm going to roll and see how it goes. That's what I'm going to do.
Julia's here. It can only go well.
I'm going to use a luck die. So yeah, get the hell out of here.
What did I come into?
7.
Rolled really badly.
Oh no.
Can I I don't remember a luck die. Can I add an inspiration to that or no?
You would have had to have given yourself you can do a donation inspiration, yes.
Yes. Yes. Okay, what's that? A D
D12.
So 25 total.
Damn.
On a 25, you're not sure. You remember from that vision, it was a large crowd, that is for sure. It was people who are well-dressed, and in fact, if anything, what hits you is the dress of some of the people, or the type of dress that you saw the type of dress that you saw as you were coming through the Stoneward Rush, being very similar to the dress, the attire that folks were wearing in your vision so long ago of people laughing, sort of very affluent, well-to-do folk. But as far as it being this exact location, you are not... nothing about this location rings a bell as it being the exact place. It is more the feeling of this is the type of society that you were in than necessarily the location that you were in. If that makes sense. So, as you emerge out, in the first thing you see is this amphitheater that is centered, but you are led and to either side. Everyone do me a perception check to see what catches people's eyes first.
Can I, quick question, in the stone, in the basin,
yep.
What sort of shops could Axel actually pick out in there?
We'll use your perception, this perception roll to judge by what we're going to have, what you yep. saw.
Would Vidar see any, like, open clothing shops or anything? Because he's yeah. basically just got his cloak of protection pulled very tightly around him. And he's raised on.
So
they can feel the cold now.
So, Celia, I would say, as you enter this area, I mean, you get the best sense of the population here. It is younger elves. It is elves of having fun. You also, you're able to spot there are folks who are in this area to take advantage of potentially of people who might have drunk too much. There are eyes watching the streets, watching people. You also notice what are probably Talengard in civilian clothes, keeping an eye on things as well. That's with your with that above 20 perception. Most of the rest of you are all landed about the same place. Axel, back as far as shops go, you saw in just a little bit along this main street, you saw quite an assortment of things. You didn't necessarily. Is there anything specific you were looking for?
Clothes shops, artisans in terms of crafters, or not so much like smiths, but jewelers and things like
yes.
that.
Yes, for sure. As you were entering in this area in Vidar, you would have seen there certainly were shops that had had clothes in their windows. They don't seem to have clients in them right now, as it is getting a little bit later in the evening, but certainly there are shops that would have had, seem to be clothing stores. Axel, as you always have an eye for trinkets and things that shine, certainly there are shops that had some sparkly things in them. I would say probably where you noticed most of those were sort of at the top of the basin, just as you were exiting the Stoneward Rush before coming down into this area, potentially where you would have had more affluent folks not wanting to make the trip all the way down into the Windward Basin. Along the Stoneward Rush, probably you would have picked up on some more well-heeled jeweler shops, etc. As far as crafters and artisans of all sorts, knick-knacky things to what seem to be well-made, everything from trinkets to bags to arts of all types, painters, sculptors, very much an art related, but also the arts of crafting as well, sort of the lighter crafting things. Alchemists would be found in this area, things like that. The rest of you, the big thing... Oh, go ahead, Luna.
I was going to say, so she's not going to ask out loud, but she is going to... Luna is going to keep an eye out for any establishments that have red lanterns hanging from them at some angle.
Okay. what was your perception? On a 10. You do not notice any red lanterns. However, as you pass by a cross street, in very fine clothes, skirts, well-tailored dress, with a, oh my God, I can't think of the name of it. The thing that you tie around your waist.
Apron?
No, they're tight, like Renaissance, begins with a C. You lace up in the back.
Corsets?
Corsets, thank you. Corseted, you see a well-corseted, I don't know where my brain was. In a high corset, beautifully sculpted hair of fire as she strolls down the street away from you. Seems to be...
Luna probably stops sketching for a moment and just follows her progress.
Yep. You see that she heads down before going underneath of those buildings. You see her heading down to the left of the main road on one of the sort of, not a side street, sort of one of the main crossroads. Hey, codpiece too. There's guys who are courtiers. Courtiers are a male courtesan. What's a male courtesan? Don't know.
They're still courtesans.
Yeah, they're still courtesans. So you do notice that. As you guys emerge from the other side, Iska's eyes are on this amphitheater and trying to place herself, whether she recognizes this place. The rest of your eyes are drawn over to the left. Axel, it is something you've only ever seen in a sketch or a drawing. The rest of you, it is a marvel beyond imagining. It is a huge structure that looks like a ship, but it is made out of woven gold and filigree, gemstones and steel, and you see it towering to the left of where you entered, what would be on sort of the northern side of the overhang district. What could only be an airship. You guys, as you continuing on, Axel drawn that way, Iskrin, what you notice as your guide takes you sort of over to the right, away from where this airship is, you see sort of centered behind this this large amphitheater, you see a tower, square, maybe 5-6-sided, possibly. You can't get a real bit of the shape from here, but it is an amazing tower. I gotta click. I gotta see what it is. Absolutely. Best meme ever. But anyway, it is, it stands out even among this outer row of residences as being far more ornately built, far more intricate, huge glass vaulted vaulted windows that run up the sides of it, and it seems as though it was maybe potentially part of a larger structure at one point. It's interesting, just the lines of it don't continue the way you would expect them into something of that that level of construction to be sort of isolated to this one tower that it might be what's left of something that was once much larger and far more, even more magnificent than what is left.
Huh. Excuse me, so that tower over there, what's its significance? Its construction's a lot different than everything else.
Oh, that's the Windward Star. It is all that remains of the Greymont Castle.
Oh. So, if I have my histories correct, was that the last standing tower before the elves came?
No, the castle stood past the Sylvan War. When the last of the Greymonts died, as we became led by the Viceroy, we used the stones, the blood of the Greymonts, to rebuild the rest of the city. But we wanted part to remain. This whole area, and he basically motions to the entire Windward Basin, is the foundation of the Greymont, of what was once the Greymont Castle.
I guess you could also call it a tombstone, but that's interesting.
Some do. Many still mourn the loss of the Greymonts, even though it was over two millennia ago.
Would you say that's more human, or...?
Oh, those who just, I think, love the romance of the old days.
Yes, true.
But here, we're almost... Go ahead.
Why would they just take it apart? I mean, was it representative, or did they really, really need to, or to just...
Hey, trolls, thank you! Oh my gosh. We'll get to that, man. I was going to say, it's not really one of our donation levels this month. I'll give you a shout about some of the things that we do have available. Trolls meet and donate $25.
Yay.
And he looks to Axel, and he goes, little both. Much of the city was in ruins. Luckily, magics helped protect the castle, so it was some of the best building stone, and it felt as though we could have the Greymont legacy live on in everybody's home instead of just in a single castle. So it was dismantled by the people, by the aristocracy, by the viceroy, the nobles, and used in service to the people who were most affected by the war.
So everyone gets to live in a castle.
As they say in Falcon's Crest, everyone under one roof.
And actually, yeah, that's actually quite accurate. That's just interesting. Do you know if they have like any sort of designs or drawings or the maps of the castle as it was? If that would be kept anywhere that I could, you know, public access.
Oh, I'm sure, in the histories, yes. Some of the historical archives, perhaps in Sentinel Row, would have such a thing.
Oh, okay. Okay, so I was going there anyway, then. Thank you. Thank you.
Before we move on, can you say the name of that structure and what district we're in real quick?
We are in it's called the Overhang District.
Making sure we're still here. What was the name of that tower again?
It is the Windward Star.
Oracles, man. Blinding people and stuff.
Oop, that's way too loud. Sorry.
That's nice. That's good.
So, as you guys sort of exit from the sort of hustle and bustle of the Windward Basin and through this amphitheater and out here further into the Overhang District. As I say, you see this large airship over to one side, your guide takes you over to the right. And after all these questions, he sort of looks, I think, to Luna, or maybe even Iska, whoever, who's riding next to your guide, as no one's asked his name.
Luna's up front, so...
Didn't he introduce himself last time?
I don't think so.
We don't have his name.
I mean, doesn't know our names either.
That's true, actually. That's very true.
Yeah. Well, that's the question. I didn't know if you all were intentionally not introducing yourself.
Luna, intentionally not.
Yeah.
Iska, also intentionally not.
Luke just forgot.
I was going to say, maybe we don't. Maybe he doesn't introduce himself.
Kel, intentionally not.
So,
Vidar Lycrin.
Yeah, intentionally not.
We are all Andy.
And Iskren can't stop yelling his own new name.
Yes.
I'm Vidar, by the way. My real and true name is Vidar.
Yeah.
Totally. My name is Vidar.
Take it easy, Vidar.
Yeah. And so, upon him finally paying attention to Vidar, having kind of ignored him as everyone does,
old, painted elf. Leave him alone. He's hurt. He feels.
That's just a little bit more than I want. But so he looks to him and goes, "Yes, I've heard, Vidar. It's nice to meet you. Well, you've said it 10 times. I'm Lyndon Bandershanks."
Hello, Lyndon. Good evening. What's the typical greeting here in Falcon's Crest?
Good evening, good day. Either works. Depending on the time, is getting quite late here. As you guys see, as you get closer, he goes, "We're almost there. We're going to the air docks." As you head over, you see in front of you a long, low building, not to break sort of the view from the amphitheater, but it sort of is a even lower part of the Overhang District. That you sort of wind down to, and you actually can see where there are what looks like stone piers that stick out into the sky. There's nothing docked there, of course, but there is this long, low building that has many big double doors in them. They are wooden doors, which are actually the first wooden doors you've seen since entering the city. On the outside of the building, you see a sign that says Lindfort Libations. It is a stone construction. It's good repair, obviously, is actively in use. There are multiple sets of these double doors. And Lyndon looks to you guys as you sort of pull up outside and goes, "Do you have any belongings that you need? I can take the wagon's holding the whiskey in so we can begin getting it barreled properly. I can't imagine what's happened to it in this awful transport."
Is he asking if we still have anything left in the wagon?
Yeah, basically he's about to take the wagons. Two wagons that have the whiskey in them.
There we go.
Yes. Yeah. We can park this third one for you if you'd like. It's horses, of course, are a luxury in the city. You will need to, unescorted, be able to show that you have paid the proper tariffs for having
city tax will get you every time.
Just out of curiosity, where do we pay if we choose to ride a horse through the city?
Back at the front entrance.
And how much?
For a horse and a wagon, it's 50 gold a day.
Duh. It's gonna make that noise.
Sounds like we're gonna walk a lot of places.
Yep.
Cardio, let's go. Hashtag D&D fitness.
There you go.
It's good for the heart. So, kids these days with their horses, next thing you know, they'll have stubby legs.
Well, we get all our stuff off the wagons that we need to, at least.
Well, and again, you have this other wagon that I assume you're planning on actually
parking taking somewhere.
Oh, well, yeah, or taking to the orphanage that seems to have been the original owners.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right, the orphans.
And we will sell them their food back at triple the price.
Not a triple, you one and you. A half. We're not monsters.
All right, so get all our stuff off the wagons that he's dropping off here, then. Transfer it to the other one.
Okay. Okay, so, you know, as you walk down this this building, you do see in front of you, it is almost dizzying. You are walking basically towards the edge, and out in front of you, you are seeing the rolling fog as it rises inside of Misty Moon Valley, the sun setting, turning sort of a rose color overhead. And you get go past all these double doors and find yourself into this more elaborate entrance. You see some of these very ornate stonework and glass doors showing sheafs of grain and looks like outlined with sort of distillation tubes. And then at the bottom, you know, barrels is the sort of motif of these two double doors that come together to form the this pitcher. And as they open it up, Linford opens it up and sort of ushers you inside. You see a half-elven male sort of hop up immediately upon seeing your arrival. And starts waving to you, yes, this way, please. Takes you through another large wooden door into a office. And it's very nice office. Again, wooden floors, wooden walls, which you've not seen everything. Everything else that you've bumped into so far has been made from stone, even down below. Very little wood construction. They are all beautifully polished wood floors, wooden walls. Directly across from you, huge windows, probably 18 feet tall, that look out into the sunset as it's over the valley and what looks like a sea of clouds as it rises up towards the plateau. The there are bookshelves that line the other walls. And to your right side, you've see a large desk. Behind it are multiple ends of barrels, circles, that have been cut off to only leave them probably about 3 or 4 inches deep. Each top branded with a number and usually, or some sort of a name in quotes. And underneath each of one of them, you see what looks like some kind of a plaque, an award, or a medal down below it. Behind the desk, you see a lean, older human man, sort of shorter stature, sort of bald on top, but with well-trimmed, sort of white, or salt and pepper sort of sides of his hair. Even Luck has to admire this man's majestic handlebar mustaches, well waxed and oiled. You see him stand up. He's wearing a well-tailored shirt. He has a vest that's over top of it that is sort of amber and gold, almost with a deep brocade on it, sort of that shimmers like as though it was almost like liquid as he stands up and goes, Yes, yes, come in, come in. Oh, so here we are, here we are. My very own heroes of the day. Yes, come in, Beauregard Linford. Pleased to meet you. And he puts his hand out and starts coming out to just start grabbing hands and shaking them as he's going along and just, yes, oh, so nice, so nice. And
Who's the first you directed at?
Yeah. I will go that he probably walks up to... He probably... Who would have entered first? I'll say he walks up to Iska first. We're going to go down the line here. Walks up to Iska first.
Cruise between two. Come on.
Yeah.
Shakes hands and introduces herself as Elise. Elise Gray. The name that she gave to Wallace Linfort back at the other tavern.
Look at so, you taking
keeping
notes.
It consistent.
Elise, yes, I heard of you. You met Wallace. Oh, and where's your courtesan? There was supposed to be a courtesan here? Oh, my note's wrong. Lawrence!
What's a courtesan?
Because Luna doesn't look like herself, she's going to actually smile. Big smile.
And so he, I guess with a big smile, he goes over next to Luna and starts shaking. Yes, so nice. Nasty business that was. Nasty business down at the lifts. You are?
You can call me Lucy.
Lucy, so nice to meet you. So nice to meet you. Oh, and the big gentleman, you must have been key in all this effort here. Yes, who are you? Beauregard,
You can't lie on the spot. Luck Goldheart. Nice to meet you.
Oh, Luck Goldheart. Oh, nice. Yes. And I assume Kel's still hood up and everything. Do you let him get an in to come?
Subtly shift as he's introducing himself so that I'm kind of circling around behind the people he's already...
Okay. Absolutely.
To sort of jump in and say, hi, I'm...
Oh, yeah, and absolutely. He's like, oh, that's Baxi. Yes, yes, yes. I heard all about you. And he's totally just like, someone gave him notes of who he should be introducing. He's full of it. And, oh, a moon elf? No one said there was a moon elf. Hello, how are you? So nice. You've done wonderful service for us. Thank you.
Vidar Lycrim.
Vidar, what a wonderful name. Good to see you. Thank you so much.
Of the Fallonwood. Nice to meet you as well.
Oh, Falinari. Isn't it wonderful this time of year? So lovely. It moves on. And you are... Oh. Balathira. Are you from Balathira?
Celia will hide. She's not in the mood to introduce herself to anyone.
Oh, a shy one. I understand.
Don't
I understand.
Get going.
Yeah, so... Totally understand. And he just keeps on just barreling through all this.
No pun intended.
Come in. Yes, have a seat. He looks around. There's only two seats. He's like, Lawrence, we'll be in the meeting room. And he like gathers up like a carafe and four glasses. He's like, and glasses, bring glasses. And he goes walking across like right through the middle of you guys. There's two doors like directly behind you, that he turns around, like bumps his butt into, wham, they slam open and into another huge room. This one with a giant table, giant stone table in the middle of it. Again, the whole wall that faces outward with floor to ceiling windows. You can see there actually look like there's glass doors here that open onto a terrace outside. And he's like, yes, yes, this will be so much nicer, a place for everyone to sit. And he just starts dropping glasses down, starts pouring. You see the poor half-elf who was out in the front room come in. He's actually brought a tray whereas Beauregard was sort of juggling glasses and a craft. He actually has a tray and sets them down nicely and starts just pouring. Around there are wooden chairs around the stone table, which are beautifully carved and well polished. Floor here is granite, though table is granite.
I imagine while all that business is happening, Luna is actually like, is like over at Iska and just muffling her laughter in her shoulder. Like she's cracking up.
It was just like Iska's, I know.
Yeah. And, so, yes, a toast to you and your party for such a wonderful service you've done to the Linfort family today. Over the last couple days. 3 days? 2 weeks? How long has it been? Anyway, a toast!
And, to the Linfort family.
Truly, you ought to be commended. Such wonderful work.
We went into another room?
Yes, you are in a large conference room, basically, now.
Okay.
Out of from his office.
Kel did not follow.
Okay. And he sees that there's one glass left. He goes, did we lose one? And looking around.
Some of our companions are less friendly than others.
I wouldn't say friendly. Maybe social. Yeah, I don't know.
Well, he wanders back actually in because he's not wild about having. He actually, Lawrence has stopped in the office. He's not wild about his boss's office being left unattended if that's where you remained, was in Beauregard's office. I think.
Is this attached directly to the
office? To the office. It's attached directly to the office. Yeah. It's sort of like his private conference room. I'm trying to think. I think that you're going to have Lawrence, who's going to be trying to shepherd you that direction. Sort of keep, hound dogging you. Not pushing you, but just probably invading your space so that you eventually make it to the conference room so he can close
the doors. If that's the case, I will dodge him and I will just walk out the way we came in and go back outside and leave.
Okay. Cool. His big concern was having someone in there, and you walk outside. Beauregard sort of looks around, looks in the office, and Lawrence sort of points outside. He's like, yeah.
Fresh air. Long journey here.
Yes, quite. Huh. Well, okay. Anyway, truly.
Kel will go to our remaining wagon and stay with the wagon.
Okay.
Actually, probably for the best, someone stays with that wagon.
truly, you are to be commended, all of you. Yes. Wallace gave me a few details, and I can suspect the rest, of course. Best not to talk about such things. You know what they say here in Falcon's Crest. The stones always are listening, and the fog has eyes. What brings you to Falcon's Crest?
Our feet.
Why, yes, they do. I love someone with a humor. It pours more into your glass. It is incredibly good whiskey.
Stop awkwardly just sitting like, this guy's a little eccentric. Like, this is too high class for Nook. It's like, not awkward. He's friendly, but he's high class. So it's just all that awkward, just like, common folk.
Luna kind of has
your
that
feet.
Permanent,
yes,
friendly,
so
I'm smiling because I don't know what to do face.
Right. And so he just keeps looking at you, waiting for more, and then so he then looks to, he looks to your high charisma people, looks to Iska and to Vidan, and you, what brings you here?
With the, correct my terminology if I'm wrong here, but with the Convergence coming up, we thought we'd come in, we've new to Falcon's Crest and have never seen such a celebration of this size, and just want to get a first-hand account of it.
So are you actually thinking, I mean, the Convergence doesn't happen in Falcons.
I know, but they do
yeah,
the thing
yeah,
here before
I mean,
they, that's what I'm talking
well,
about.
Goes,
I don't know
yes,
that.
There will be quite a send-off indeed. There will be. Yes, after Solstice, and we have all that to look forward to. Thank goodness you brought in, got this whiskey here. It would have been missed so much if it was not able to make it to some of the celebrations up at Sentinel Row. They do like our product, as you can see. And again, medals all across the walls of in whiskey tops of whiskey barrels.
And now I can absolutely understand why, as she takes another sip.
Oh, aren't you a dear? And
this is gonna be the first time Vidar's ever tasted alcohol, and it's like straight up whiskey, I like punched to her face. So I'm gonna make a constitution check to see how he handles.
Okay. It is really smooth whiskey, but it is still whiskey on a 9.
Just very awkwardly. tries to drink the entire thing, but like, he's like, oh, okay.
He comes over to sort of patch on, like, oh, down the wrong pipe. I understand it can happen sometimes.
God.
Of course, I'm more used to the culinary wines. It's still nice. Smooth. Good.
Yes, yes, yes. And he sort of looks at your attire now, bare feet, and he was like, I assume a tailor brings you, yes, to Falcon's Crest.
That would be wonderful. Unfortunately, circumstances on the road, you see, going around through the vineyard.
Oh, yes, I heard that. Yes, it is a tricky path that way, it is. And yes, strange things along the way. Hope it wasn't too rough for you. And he moves on. He doesn't want to hear the story. And like, what's everyone else doing in the room?
He half finishes the sentence being like, so why is that? Oh.
Lucy will ask, just like, oh, this place must looked really nice. It must have been expensive.
Oh, well, this, our offices here, well, they're the old docks, you see. It's where the airships used to come in. These were the terminals. And, of course, when that all went away, someone needed to take over, and the Lindfort family, you know, stepped in, of course, as good citizens that we are, to take the property off of the city's hands and to make it useful once again. And it's close to the Sentinel lifts, which is always nice, so we're able to get our product up here. But this time of year, you know, everything gets backed up. That's why Wallace had to bring it in a more subtle way. He kind of, you know, insinuates, knowing that that's not the normal path to bring things into the city. And it'll do. And you know, he's being very self-deprecating because it is damn nice.
It is certainly excellent. And out of curiosity, what relation is Wallace to you?
Oh, he's my great nephew, yes.
Ah.
Yes, all part of the first family, us, the Band of Shanks, you know, related in there as well.
You don't look old enough to be a great uncle.
Oh, well, he sort of gives you, a familiar elbow. The old Lindfoot family tree gets a little straight in places. And takes a drink. Little intertwined in places.
Yeah, I know the feeling of, you know, my family's damn good show at keeping younger than you actually are.
Oh, you'll learn the problems of age as they come. And
Yes.
He sort of looks around all of you and is like, well, now, it was wonderful meeting you all, And he like literally is now already starting to usher you out. Now, I won't insult any of you with gold for what this outstanding service. I know I would hate to do that to you, but I hope that you won't take offense that I've left instructions at the Windward Star to provide you room and board for the length of your stay. It's the least I could do, the very least that I could do for such a service that you've done. And certainly you will always have a friend in the Lindfort family and the First Family's alliance. So wonderful. Thank you. And literally he's like,
can I grab the name of that tailor?
Hmm? Yes.
Can I grab the name of that tailor, good sir?
A tailor, yes. Down, oh yes. Well, what are you looking for exactly? Tell you what, I will send my personal tailor up to your rooms.
Oh, thank you, good sir. I'm looking for that more of a waistcoat trend that's going on.
Oh, of course. So only the most stylish. Only the most stylish. He is not stylish at all.
you got us there.
Back to work. I must get back to work. Yes, business to attend to. Business to attend to.
Thank you for everything.
Now, Lyndon. Lyndon will get you to the Windward Star now with no problem. So, be on your way. Get a so nice. He's like totally trying to get you out.
All right, bye.
I don't think any of us are dragging our feet. Yeah. I think we're all looking to get them out of here.
You find yourself outside. Kel is out there waiting.
I make eye contact with Kel. Make eye contact with Kel and just go.
Yeah, there are people who keep like coming over and trying to help Kel. They keep coming over to you, Kel, and are like, "We can take your wagon. Do you need anything, sir?"
No.
Okay. You see, at one point, Lawrence comes out and sort of checks on you again, and then goes back in, and then the party does finally come out.
we don't have to talk to that guy again, right?
You do see Lyndon is standing there, sort of waiting for you guys. And he kind of his eyes widened. Yes, Uncle Beauregard is the leader of the family.
Charismatic and energetic.
He is, yes.
He's
popular. At social gatherings. Yeah,
quick question, just the last cart, we got it with the other two, but we do need to deliver it to its owners, who were the orphanage here in town. What was the name again?
Tangled Braids.
Does anyone know? Asking.
On
the boxes.
Lyndon looks at you and goes, down in the knot. Yes, you will need a place to keep it. We could keep it here overnight for you if you would like. There's not many places for wagons and horses over at the Wynwood Star. We'll be locked up and well taken care of.
Appreciated.
Yeah.
Of course. It's the least we can do for you all.
Yes.
And so you guys are escorted. Actually along what's known as the Ridge Road, which passes... do me constitution checks, everyone.
No, babe.
I am quite cold.
Luna and Kel... it is uncomfortably close to basically a 4,000-foot drop as the Ridge Road literally runs around the old cliff, the very edge of the cliff face of the air docks as you approach. And as you are traversing it, you kind of warily are seeing, and perhaps it might be for Kel the fog that is more disturbing than the height, as it is having...
I was going to say, because the height isn't really a thing for me, just because of...
Yeah. So the biggest thing right now is, with your last 2 days, the fog is creeping up and will be all lipping, pretty much nipping at your ankles as you guys in front of you see the tower of the Windward Star in front of you. The road sort of dives in around the tower so that you're able to go in through the front doors. The doors are palatial. Two huge, probably 12-foot tall double doors that are already thrown wide open. You see now, as the fog is starting to rise in the air and the mist is starting to collect, it's not fog that obscures vision yet. You will see these sconces that hold these sort of blue egg-shaped stones begin to glow and let off a blue light. And you can see now that each one of these, the way that the sconce is formed, it makes a little basin underneath of it to collect whatever water is pooled out of the air by these very small versions of the cistern stones. As you walk in, it is this beautiful lobby of stone and wood and curved glass. Yes? Do you go in? Actually, that's the first question.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt, but as we're going along, Kel is going to be making specific notice and looking for like anything that's like park or garden or place where there are plants.
Go ahead, like, and do me perception
perhaps check. Like in those the medians, those mm-hmm. median areas.
Yep. Do me a perception check.
And I'm going to use a luck die to reroll that. Fuck. Really?
So, actually, in this area, especially right close to the edge, there are gardens, but it's not gardens like you were looking for or expecting. They are rock gardens. It is formations, you know, artistically arranged formations of stone, usually geometric in nature, unlike sort of like the gardens in Japan that are usually swirls. Most of this is stones that are laid in very geometric patterns, and there aren't many of them. For the most part, in fact, pretty much across your trip, very much of this city is has been developed and are buildings. And even here on the Ridge Road, there are buildings right up on the other side of it. As you'd see, there's what were probably old warehouses or old businesses that were servicing the docks, but no longer open this direction onto the Ridge Road. It doesn't seem like it has traveled much, whereas you've been around people for the most part. This very sparsely used pedestrian walkway leading over to the Windward Star from the Linfert Libations offices.
Okay.
As I said, you head in this incredibly beautiful lobby. As most everything in this part of town, set up to have views that look out over the valley. At this point, there's actually not a whole lot of a view as the fog has risen basically and is lipping up against it. In fact, if anything, you're getting this weird effect of the fog being so thick that you see gray on the lower half of the window and actual the remains of the night sky above it as fog is about to pretty much overtake the whole top of the peninsula. The only thing keeping it at bay from your entryway is some of the cistern stones that were pulling water out of the fog as quickly as it was forming, but they won't be able to keep up for much longer. The ceilings are vaulted up above you, and there are ornate tapestries and lush patterned rugs on the floor. There's that smell of sort of clean, polished stone and balsam and sort of amber spice that fill the air. There are two huge hearths that flank the hallway that are giving off warmth and sort of drying the air somewhat from the fog that, you know, just sort of makes the humidity high. Straight ahead of you, you see big windows in a curved glass, a curved formation, sort of like a semicircle with eight panes in it that reach up 2 to 3 stories. This lobby itself, in fact, you can see is multiple stories high, where you can see that there are rooms on higher levels that look down, and two large stone circular staircases that lead up to the second floor and beyond. Basically, as you sort of enter the center of this, Lyndon just goes, wait here one moment. I'll get all your keys and everything that you will need.
Okay.
As you guys...
And this is the remnants of the Greymont Castle, right? This correct. Is the Windward Star? Okay.
Yeah. You are in the Windward Star Inn, which is the last standing tower of the Greymont Palace. You see Lyndon run over to a desk that is over... sort of in a nook over to the left, and speaking animatedly to the person behind it. And after a few moments, anything you guys want to do while he's getting your keys?
Just so we're clear, what names are we going to go by while we're here?
Silly was hiding. Has she shown up yet?
Yeah, Celia. Did you go in and have whiskey with everyone, or did you just disappear?
Oh, she disappeared.
Did you catch back up with them when they came out?
Yeah, you would have.
Okay. So, do you go into the Windward Star?
She's going to go over to somebody and be like, is there a spa or a bathhouse that I can go to?
You get a strange look from a random stranger that you ask this to. Nope. So are you, I mean, are you in the lobby with everyone else? I mean, you could have asked Lyndon along the way.
Sure, let's do that.
Or when he gets back, either way. We'll do it when he gets back. Anything else you guys want to do? Do y'all want to talk name, figure out names now, or wait till you get to your room?
Yeah, I think that's... Yeah. So, Locke has already introduced himself as Locke, so that's stuck.
Yeah.
Axel, but I can always... You know, Axel is the nickname. I can always extend it into something else.
Shown by Axel.
Ah. funny. That's good.
Well... Okay, so we have Elise, Lucy, Vidar, Axel is malleable, Luck is Luck Goldheart, because of course he's going to be Luck Goldheart.
Yes.
I don't know what
I was going to say. Kel ran and Celia ran.
Luck, just keep being you. I would say a fake name would be great, but you're also about 40 years younger than anyone who last saw you would remember you.
Good point.
So we'll wait for Danny to get back for Kel, but
because he ran.
Just give me 2 seconds. No, I'm going for you.
So does for mine for me. I mean, this entire body is a mask. The entire thing is a fake name.
I don't think that's how it works. I think it's called Disguise.
La, Disguise. You there? You awake, buddy?
Disguise. Working. I'm still working on the final touches.
It's getting there.
And remind me, Axel still has his trinket that basically changes his appearance for... As long as he has it, correct?
Yep.
Well, the thing is, of course, he's had that since...
True. That's true.
Yeah. He's not recognizable as a member of the Wandering Tribe. At this point, he's been making a name for himself as Axel, so...
Yeah. He looks far more generic.
About that time, we'll say that Lyndon comes back. I'll get you to your room so you could ask your question at this point.
Yeah, she's gonna be like, is there a spa or a bathhouse?
Well, there's baths in your room, of course.
I need a massage.
Oh, that can be arranged. Absolutely. Would you like them brought to your room? And at that point, as he's walking, he's leading you across the lobby and to the left of these towering windows, and you can see there appears... From there, you can see that there appears to be a bar on the right side, and actually that leads out onto a terrace that overhangs. The only way you're able to see it is because it is outside the windows, but is covered in cistern stone, so it actually is this weird little clear spot of fog out there. You go down a hallway that led off to the left, and he hands each one of you actually 4 sets of 2 keys, a large key and a small key. And he just looks at you and goes, large key will open the main door, and goes click, and opens these 2 double doors, and you see in front of you a huge 2-story room with glass windows on the far side of it, a large common space, it has wooden floors and real furniture. There are lounging couches in it. There is an outdoor terrace. And you see to either side of you, almost like there was in the main lobby, stone staircases that lead up to a second level that each have sort of indoor terraces that look down. And the other four keys, as he hands them out, he goes, and these go to each of your private rooms, and there are four doors in this place. And I'll go by Derek's look of what Iska looks like, and he goes, well, the Linforts do own the building, you know. And he goes, I'll leave you to your night's rest. And hands you the last key and closes the doors.
Doors are closed?
Yeah, he closes the two.
Luna books it to her whatever room she has a key for, is hopping in a bath.
Yeah, you go in there. I mean, this is a Vegas suite, baby. This is like suites in Vegas. It is a big two-story one. There are four private rooms. Each room has private baths, and with running water, which is incredibly rare here because of water being a rare commodity. You've been taken care of quite nicely for, you know, returning 24,000 gold pieces of whiskey to the Linfort family.
Admittedly, like, once the door is closed, X looks around. But I have a feeling something's going to go wrong.
Because it always does, but I'm going to try to enjoy this just a little bit longer.
So, Luna, do you take an upstairs room or one of the main floor rooms?
Upstairs.
Okay, so you run up the stone stairs and open the door. You go in. There is a bed that looks like a cloud that is inside of it. And you do see there's another door, and it is easy for you to spot. And it's strange, because you wouldn't have expected this. It is a stone basin tub that is at least 8 feet long, probably 4 feet wide, and almost 4 feet deep that is in there. You can see where you can basically, there is a tap of, you know, for all intents and purposes. And something you recognize, but was not where you would have thought it to be, something that looks very similar to Iska and Axel's boiling stone for you to be able to put in the tub to warm the water.
Awesome. She's sleeping in this tub. I mean, she's going to clean off her, and she's going to sleep here.
Yep, so Luna has found her way. How about the rest of you guys and gals? We definitely get to Kel of how he's taking all this. I assume you followed the group back to the room.
Well, I didn't see any other options, so it's just stay together. But once he sees the layout of this place, he's going to head straight for the outer terrace, the terrace that's outside.
Okay. You go out there. There are, it's mainly fogged in at this point. There is no real view to speak of, but it is, you can tell, you know, you're outdoors. The air is cool. There is a brisk breeze that almost comes from like below you. It's as as you are out here on this terrace, in the overhang district, it is, blowing.
Are there any plants on the terrace?
There are no plants on the terrace. There are some stone sculptures that are out there. There is a stone sort of balustrade along the outside. There's some chairs, actually more like benches that are built, you know, stone carved benches that are in it. And as always, cistern stone sort of spaced along that are collecting, giving light and collecting water and sort of trying to lessen the fog.
And what time of day is it at this point?
We're at about 8:30, 9 o'clock at night, and you know, we're at this point, the city is deeply fogged in, as it is now, you know, flowed over the city, as you guys had seen all the way back from the Arbor Leafs, of how the whole plateau gets covered in fog as the night goes on.
How many doors are there out onto this terrace, and how big are they?
You notice there is the main set of doors, sort of double doors. They're almost like French doors. Think of it as stained glass, though. I mean, they're these stone lead line, but with stone. Double doors that are come off of the central room, and it appears that there is also a door off of each one of the two lower rooms as well, out onto the terrace.
Oh, then I will go towards one of those doors.
You go over there, it's currently locked from the inside, but I mean, you could figure out which key is the right key to that room and be able to sort it out.
Okay, that's what I will do next, okay. Just to determine which room opens out onto the, say, if I walk out onto the terrace, the one to the left.
Okay, so it doesn't take long for you guys to sort of juggle keys around and figure which ones go to which room, so that you all can, you know, have your own sort of private locking doors. And you figure out the left-hand room, and you know, it's again nicely appointed. There is a large bath in there. There is give me a second. Lower rooms each have two sort of, it's like two, you know, two doubles or two queens, whereas the upper ones have like a king type idea. Think of, you know, give us in hotel terms just so for quick description. But yeah, there's two beds in here. They are large. If you were to compare, the bathrooms aren't quite as big as the ones upstairs, but certainly functional, and have, you know, running water. Again, true novelty.
Kel doesn't even know what that is.
Right. No, absolutely. I'm just, you know, for description's sake. But yeah, construction, again, mainly stone here. The blocks are monolithically big. Like, think Egypt pyramids big. These were not just someone laying, you know, cinder block to build this, or even larger, you know, blocks. They are car-sized blocks that were used to build this structure. And when needed to have more granularity sort of to the detail, they were carved into the shape that they needed to be carved into, but still hugely monolithic in size.
So issue is, of course, we have, I think it was four rooms, right?
Four rooms.
And we have seven of us, so who's going to be sharing the downstairs room, because we've got two sick beds in each. Kel, are you going to
Leave
the door
open to
the outside? Luna's
sleeping in the tub. So.
Yeah, she's already claimed one.
Okay, there we go.
To be clear, she left all the doors open on her way in. She is not closed off her room at all.
Yeah.
So, right, so, no bunk beds.
No, but there are two big beds in these rooms.
There's a total of six beds in this suite.
Kel isn't going to talk to anyone. He's going to go into the room that he got the key for. He's going to shut the door. If somebody else wants to open it, that's their business. He will go into the bathroom, and presuming he can figure out how the taps and the water works.
I would say, I mean, well, let's do this. Do an intelligence check. I mean, you've used a pump before. You know what a pump is. On a 13, you can figure it out fairly quickly of how to draw water into this tub.
I don't want to discount what's going on or Kel's journey right now, but it's so funny to me that Kel is currently in a Vegas suite trying to figure out how a bathtub works. I just really like that imagery so much.
It's so good.
So he will, once he figures it out, fill it to as full as it will go, get in, submerge himself, bathe, and he will mainly keep his eyes closed and just remember back to the spring where they camped when they first met.
Cool.
And reflect on how long ago that was and all that's happened since then. And then he will dry himself, dress himself, put on the cloak and the hood, go out onto the terrace and kind of wedge himself in the interior corner.
Okay.
And just stay out there as with his back to the wall and take his long rest there.
Okay.
And he will not talk to anybody. He will not respond if he's questioned.
Gotcha. So Lux looking for bunk beds. How about Iska and Axel? Because we are going to spend some time with Vidar and Celia when we get to them.
Axel's probably just gonna sort of spend his time actually exploring the central area. Oh, this is neat. This is neat. And he's just sort of waiting for everyone else to sort themselves out before he jumps in and acquires a room, a bed to
as
start
you,
pulling all this stuff apart.
As you wander around the main part of the room, and of course, everyone was drawn to the rooms and to the windows, but back sort of towards the door, and as the door had opened it, the two doors opened, kind of obscured it, you do find a bar, well stocked with Linford's finest. You do find there seem to be some rations and food that is there too. Nicely, you know, fruit sort of laid out, which again, up here on the plateau, probably pretty rare to have sort of plant-based delicacies, quite frankly.
All right. He's also going to be investigating for, the upper class. So he's going to be investigating for any sort of signs of arcane things, locks, heating tools, any, he doesn't really know what these things would be, but he thinks, fancy suite might have fancy magic. He's going to be looking for anything like that as well.
So are you actually doing a detect magic, or are you,
He's going to just be looking for rooms, not a detect magic at this point.
Okay. So you guys, you look around. You do on some of the large blocks on the outer wall, what would be the outer wall of the room, do find arcane script, mainly protection and wards, as you had heard during the Sylvan War. I mean, they are ancient. But during the Sylvan War, that the castle had been, why it was intact was because much of it was protected by magics, and that these would be part of a larger sort of array. You know, alone they aren't doing much of anything, but as an array would have made a building size shield type spell.
Okay, that's interesting. So those are going to get his attention for a little while. I think he's just going to be looking over those and seeing how they work as part of a big thing.
So
that's probably what's going to take up his attention for him.
Okay.
Half hour or so.
Cool. So Iska, luck.
You said there were like fresh, like plant-based kind of food. I mean, Iska will probably had just like Axel like explored the space for a while. If she found something like that, and at some point saw Kel go to the terrace and kind of shut himself off. Not knowing if he saw those or not, she would probably grab like a small handful of those, like on a plate.
Yep.
Take them out, open the terrace door, just kind of like leave, not say anything to Kel, because Kel seems like he is zoned, and just leave them.
Okay.
And then come back inside. And I mean, she's kind of like Axel too, where she really doesn't care like whatever room she ends up in.
Yep.
Just not one with Vidar and Celia, because it seems like they got to have a conversation and she doesn't want to be part of that.
Yeah.
So she'll probably just explore the space until it's about time to call it.
Conversation.
Yeah.
I am on the same boat there. Just stand back, let things happen, and then take whatever.
Whatever's left.
Yeah. He's also just sort of moping about the lack of food.
Yeah, at this point, I gotta run for a second, but at this point...
Yeah, I was gonna say, let's all take a break before we get to Celia and Vidar, because that's gonna take a little bit, so let's do our break. We're gonna do some bio. Are you good? Okay, Alicia, to do the middle? Yep, and pun of the week. So we'll be right back. We are just gonna take a quick break and before we finish up, keep moving on with our episode. Thanks for tuning in, everybody.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the channel. If this is your first time here, welcome. If you've been here before, welcome back. This channel's run 100% for charity, with charities change every month. And this month's charity is Pathways to Safety International, an organization dedicated to helping victims of abuse international, specific U.S. citizens as they're traveling internationally. There are lots of resources on the website, but if you are on a computer that is not safe to look at, please go to a public space like a library or a cafe, check it out there. They have anything from legal council to relocation services, transitioning, all that good stuff, please go click on the purple lettering in the description to go to the website itself if you're interested. If you would like to donate through our channel to this wonderful organization, you can see our various donation levels below. Anything from a D10 healing dice for $1, an advantage for $2, a D12 inspiration for $3. For $5, you can give a player a luck dice. Luck dice being the mythical, magical mulligan dice. Any dice you roll, you can re-roll it. If you have disadvantage, you still have disadvantage. If you have advantage, you still have advantage. But the mystical $5 level. There is also the party punch bowl for $10. Name a background NPC and choose your occupation in Falcon's Crest, the city we're currently in. And for $50, give an unlimited use spoon to a player of your choice from a list provided by Tallfall or DM. So you direct message him and work it out. Also, the any dollar level, any amount, absolutely. We'll go into the spell bank, and at each $100 increment, we get a higher level spell. We are currently sitting at 120. Well, actually, hold on. I'm not sure what the first 145. So 50. No. Yes, $55 more, and we'll be up to that level too. But please feel free to donate. If you want, you can just do things like share us on social media, like Facebook and Twitter. Otherwise, thank you for joining. And since I was not here last week, we will have a palindrome along with our pun. But...
I did do a pun in your absence, just so you know.
I appreciate that. Hopefully it's not today's. Why do people like bowling puns so much?
Why?
Because they're right up their alley!
Hey, Roz! How you doing, Roz?
Hello?
My good, friend Roz, who I've known for years and years and years, used to be Wonder Woman to my Superman when we did our cosplay, has started playing Dungeons & Dragons. And
yay!
She has a... Great to see you, Roz! She is getting to starting playing. She's playing in both a Discord server and some other places. And great to see you, Roz. Thank you so much for the donation. We'll put it in the spell bank because that's coming up very soon.
Oh boy. What's the palindrome?
Oh, the palindrome is too bad I hid a boot.
I needed that boot.
Too bad.
So how come you didn't do the eyebrows, too?
There's a reason.
There you go.
There's a reason. Yep.
If you want to know, check out Tall Squall's social media accounts as he's at SDCC.
Yep. Cool things coming there, too. So, anyway... while we're waiting for folks to get back, just to reiterate, we made our big announcement for Bird in the Storm Publishing, which is coming up, which will be having its first module for folks to playtest at Gen Con, and will be available on DM's Guild coming up a little bit after that. There will be, for folks going to Gen Con, we will have badge ribbons for folks, Bird in the Storm badge ribbons for folks to... put on their badges and possibly some swag as well, including some of our cool baseball jerseys that we had made. And for folks, maybe a few little contests of if you can find us on this street corner, then you can get a t-shirt. I don't know quite how we're going to run it yet. This is new for Bird and I, so bear with us as we go through this, but we want to make sure that we don't overpromise and underdeliver, so we're taking our time on our first module and having some of our good friends out in the Dungeons & Dragons world who are DMs as well to give it some playtesting as well as running a few playtests ourselves. Can't wait to share it to you more widely. I know we've got Axel and Iska still to get back. But we'll start setting this scene just a little bit with what's ahead. Cilia, it's been a strange 2 days for you.
Yeah, it has.
Your time in the vineyard was disconcerting. And disconcerting and troubling. And after the first day when Iskrin apparently was gone, now replaced by Vidar, it's hit you and it was, I was gonna say, I should let you use your own words.
It hit me in a weak spot.
Yeah. So, yeah, describe to us a little bit what's been going through your mind over the last day as you've sort of stayed to yourself during this day of travel after last night being confronted with this moon elf, Vidar. And then we will, after we go through some of your internal monologue over the last day, we'll jump into it, the actual scene as the two of you guys are in this suite.
Well, there is a lot of cuss words that I don't feel like saying because I don't feel like donating to the curse jar.
Yep.
Right now. Because I don't have the money for that. So, there's been a lot of, like, whenever she first saw Vidar, she would have just kind of stopped, like, paused for a second, like, being that she is so close to Iskrin, she would probably notice certain similarities like face shapes and eye shapes, stuff like that. Like the small details. But like this is a completely different person. Despite it being Iskrin, this is a completely different person. Like, and what would be going through her head is, like, this person is standing here that she cares about so much, but it's not him. And it's weird. Definitely seeing being... he's erased from her past.
Okay. So, you guys have entered into this suite. Ever since East, the two of you have shared a room. You are both standing in the common room. Now, as everyone else has gone off and explored, awkwardly standing there, looking at each other.
Yeah, just like side by side, just... and there's a... and he is just like a mixed ball of emotions, like, in his face. He doesn't know how to control, like, how he's feeling his face. Like, because Iskrin could express it, be glitter. He's just like... he looks like he's about to... cry. It looks like he's about to like smile. He looks like he's about to laugh. He's all over the shop. He doesn't know his stuff. And he just.
So.
Hi.
Nilia looks at Vidar and she says, she goes, Vidar, I need to talk to you about something.
Sure, certainly. Yeah. What is it?
They're still in the common room, right?
Yep.
Or did they? Yeah. Okay. She goes, not out in the open.
Oh. Okay. Yeah, sure.
So you guys know, from you guys figuring out the rooms, you know that Luna is up in the bathtub in the upper right-hand room, but the upper left-hand room is currently empty.
Yep, we're gonna go over to the empty room.
Is that the one that's above the terrace?
It is the one above the terrace. It does not have terrace access. It is sort of, it's above Kel's room, is basically what it is. It's the room above Kel's room.
Okay.
Yep. So, Celia takes him into the room.
Oh no.
And she, I assume there's a window.
There is a window. There is a window. It is pretty much fogged in, but it sort of glows silvery. Actually, it really doesn't. It glows blue from the cistern stones, but because it's we just passed the new moon, so there's not much. The moon is up, but it is a new moon, so it's not obscured. So it is eclipsed.
Yeah.
She would. I assume there's curtains. She can like walk over and close curtains.
Yep.
Yep. So she walks over to the window and she closes the curtains.
Vidar closes the door behind him after he sees her doing that and locks it. Suspiciously.
So Celia looks at Vidar and says, this changes. I don't like it. And it's not because of you. It's because of me.
I'm feeling a tightness in my chest. I don't know why. What do you mean because of you? Why? I don't understand. Then
I'm not a Sun Elf.
Say again?
I'm not a Sun Elf.
Care to elaborate? How aren't you a Sun Elf?
So, Celia, she pulls her braids out of her hair and she lets her hair down and she sighs and she puts a hand like over her forehead, and as she does that, her form begins to change. Her skin turns blue and her hair turns dark. And before you stands a moon elf.
Literally this. Just... how? After so long, how was Anishkin able to pick up on this? Why are you keeping it a secret? What's wrong? Why? Like, what even is this? Is this because of Rollerin, your family?
I have a lot of secrets. Secrets that I honestly... I didn't think I would get close enough to somebody to tell them my secrets.
Vidar's going to go over to the bed and sit down on it. One thing you notice about Vidar is he's learning to sit and lay down, whereas Ikrin usually always floated about. Although, like, his form's, like, a little bit bulky and wider than, like, Ishrin's, like, more delicate legend form, he's still just head looking down. Like, I know between us all, we all have our secrets. I mean, between the two of you, you shared so many amazing experiences. I mean, I'm still Ishrin. That life is still me, but Ishrin is also Vidar now. And we have our friend Lyle to thank for that.
Thanks, Lyle.
Yeah, actually, you're part of this conversation too. Come here. And I'm going to bring him out of his... You muted.
You hear the crunching of popcorn from Lyle.
Lyle's like, and just eating popcorn.
Yeah. And then he actually goes, I'm just as surprised as you. Whatever magic this was, I could not penetrate it.
Name it the Ishrin site. So this is insane. Oh, by the way, I can't see the weep anymore. So technically, it's not. Yeah.
Soya says, long ago, when I left Valminari with my sister, while we were traveling, because the Elven city we were going to is the city of Sun Elves. Mem thought it best if I matched the Elven culture there.
I well, it looks like Leslie here has just had a very similar idea, little copycat that he is. I feel like that's a good thing about this for you, that you can change your form like this, apparently. However, I'm going to be like this for a while. I'm sorry.
It's different. When...
Oh?
Whenever we were... Whenever
it's okay, take your time. I could get something to drink for us. it's okay.
I haven't always been able to do that. It's weird. But whenever we were heading this way, before we hit Sanctuary, and we were all Uh, our minds were messed with.
Yeah. What happened? What happened for you?
I saw myself. Like this.
Yeah? Like in moon elf self.
Mm-hmm.
What happened there? You just saw what, were you side by side? Something happened to you?
From out of the void. Skeleton hand reached out, and when it touched me, it changed to this.
It exposed you. It turned you. I'm sorry, did it turn you actually, like, so it broke through your disguise? It broke through the magic, correct?
I don't know.
Or did it change you permanently to this? You've always been a moon elf, hiding as a sun elf. Also, fill me in.
What do we do? Well, moon elves, Salvinari, moon elves are the main elven race. Moon elf city. It's rare that a sun elf is in Salvinari, but it's like,
yeah.
Sun elves can come to moon elves, but it's a very rare thing. So people didn't think it was weird that I was a sun elf from Salvinari.
Well, I guess, especially in Balthera. Huh. And the skeletal hand just changed you. Is that all?
Well, the skeletal hand, when it touched me, it changed to my moon elf self. So it was like looking in a mirror. But so
your sun elf had to face. And you had to face your moon elf self?
I had to face my past. Yes. It's confusing, I know. I'm confused about it too.
That's fair, but I feel as if we... I feel as if we need to... A lot of us need to confront our past, and at least our demons, especially... After... Do you want to hear how it happened to Ishgrin, or do you not want to hear that? How he was in his last moments? Or I could tell you what I saw. Because I could still see through his eyes. I could still see the weave. It was like a tightrope. A horrible, terrifying tightrope into oblivion. And then I started to see them. All Ishgrin's past lives staring directly at me through the vineyard, a part of the vines itself. Those sets of blue eyes. Some red, some amber, all just staring at me. And felt that weight of responsibility that that Ishkrin, that Eladrin fiend, basically oblivious to, because he doesn't feel like this. He doesn't choke on his words. He can point at the sky and know exactly where a constellation is. All I see is clouds and stars. That was too much for me. I cut my sight. I couldn't handle that burden. I panicked. He breathes heavily and looks like he's choking on air. But then he looks up and says, I used Lyle and I cut the weave out. I can't see it. I put up the mantle while I'm here. Well, for the Dars here, I don't know. But at least they're now two moon elves in a strange situation. One's not themselves, the other one's trying not to be themselves. He stands up off the bed, and his dirty, ready clothes have probably left quite the mess on the cloud bed. Because, dirty elf.
Hold on, give me a moment. Gotta get this. Okay. So she goes, there's one more thing.
Go on.
You know that Rolarin isn't my birth last name.
Yeah, it's not, no. You remember you gave it to the guard and they were very sassy towards you? That was a nice memory.
Nelia isn't my birth name.
It's not?
No. In common, my birth name is Moonlight. In Elven, which is the name I originally went by, and it just sounds better, it's Aizome.
Azome?
Aizome.
Aizome. He's going to turn towards her. Walk up to at least within a hand distance to her. Put his hand out and say, Azome? Buda, it's wonderful to meet you.
She kind of chuckles a bit and takes his hand and says, it's nice to meet you too.
Well,
she goes, I can't change again for 24 hours, so I guess I have to tell the others.
That's true. I mean, holding her hand now with both his hands, he says, they are your friends. I mean, you are currently talking to a complete stranger. A person who has all their toes, blood, heartbeat, I mean, the only thing that's similar to Iskrin is the eyes, and even there, thanks to Lyle. But you know you can trust them, can't you? You can trust all of them. This is coming from me, a stranger, to another stranger. In a way. I mean, Luna protects you like anything. Iska's got your back, so does Kel. So does Luck. Axel as well. He's always interested in, like, he's interested in everything, but still. I don't know what that boy thinks sometimes. That's just me. I can't focus on these magic and ways anymore, but, you know, I can't keep up anymore with that. Yeah. I mean, if you feel like it, you could always just hide out here. You tend to like to hide, and apparently, thanks to the vineyard, we can't hide from our past forever, can we? Oh boy, I do not look forward to facing. Yeah, I do not look forward to facing, like, whatever the Frost Prince or the rest of Iskrin, or if Iskrin could even come back, or anything, actually. I fear what's going to happen after the moon passes, to be honest.
Go get them for me.
Okay. He's going to open up the doors. And in... Let's see. How cool do we want to be? We're not going to be cool at all. All right. First of all, he's going to go out to the terrace and just go, Kel, we need to talk inside.
How much time did this take? You're muted.
Hey, Jinx.
It's happened within like the first hour of y'all being there. I mean, a lot of this like exploring was happening.
Well, by this point, Kel would have been outside in his meditation for his long rest, so he will not respond.
Huh. We'll tell you later. I'll see you in 4 hours, buddy. Oh, after your meditation, but that's way too meta. Sorry. He's then just going to go around room by room.
Luna's naked in a tub.
Mm-hmm.
Luna hears a... Like, from way through, like, four doors in. Four doors out.
Is that far out? She ignores it.
And then it's just... Luna.
Kind of like sighs as she comes out of the water. What?
Team meeting.
How long?
Few minutes.
Fine. And so Luna will just get straight up out of the tub and walk right towards the center room. It's going to be that short. She's not getting dressed.
Okay. Naked Luna, center room.
Naked Luna, new buddy Vidar.
Axel, Iska. You guys were probably in the main room still. Luna, you hear Vidar going in, disturbing Luna, probably going, oh, this is going to be good. Then Luna comes out naked into the main room.
Kind of like arms crossed, he crossed over her chest, tapping foot.
Vidal's got that awkward hold down on the pants, and he's just like,
God.
There goes the Iskas room and knocks.
Opens the door, sees it's Vidar. Yeah?
Team meeting.
Okay, quick. And then looks over, sees naked Luna. Oh, okay.
Also, I trust you. I don't know.
Natural?
No, don't worry. Don't worry. Don't worry.
And she starts to close the door.
And then he goes, where's luck at this point?
So are Axel, Iska, and Luck all in the last room? Is that where you are?
Do we have that?
Axel was sort of like examining the outer wall. Very easily.
Templar, you're muted.
Wait, I'm muted?
Templar. Yeah, I think Axel's in. He's gone. He's done this little bit of investigation. Had a bath. It's probably just in the same room as Luck.
Okay.
Point, settling in. Which I think is the last room.
Yeah. Alright. There's a knock on the door.
Yep.
Hey guys, just a bit of a talk. We're gonna have just a quick talk.
Guys, hold up for a second. We just got super laggy. Let me see what's going on.
No.
I had some lag on the call, but it cleared up for me.
I'm hoping that it just blipped.
Yeah.
Chat, keep us updated. Let us know if it gets any better.
Pleasure and thanks.
Thank you very much, chat. You always hit.
Also, what the hell?
Hold,
OBS is showing that we're crap. Hold up for a second. I just had a backup come up. I'm wondering if it was my CPU trying to do something weird.
Yeah, now you're really slow.
Yeah. Stand by. Let me
Robo J.
Red 5 standing by.
Have you all tried D&D Beyond? It's an awesome service that you should...
D&D!
Hashtag not sponsored, but D&D Beyond, if you want to sponsor us.
Yeah, no, they don't sponsor us at all.
Yay, Tiny Axel!
Well, now our viewers are going to shoot up.
Yeah, guys, let me... I'm almost wondering whether I should stop and restart it. Do you have? Am I even still coming clear on the call?
No.
It's a little robot-y.
Yeah. It's not clear.
So in Australia, we call this what's about to happen a toolbox.
A toolbox. I need to know why.
It's a toolbox store. Before you start work, get all the